Taslima Nasrin. She is the next woman, and she's fighting for oppression and celebrating dissent. Is an award-winning writer, a physician, and an activist known for her powerful writings on woman oppression criticism of religion, despite forced exile, multiple fatwas, calling for her death. Taslima Nasrin, warm welcome, and thank you for being here.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you all. Secularism is necessary for women's freedom simply because religions, all religions, are opposed to women's freedom. No woman can have the rights and freedom she deserves under any religious laws. Women have greater rights in those countries where laws are not based on religion and where the state is separated from religion. Women are more sorely oppressed in those countries where the state and religion are not strictly separated, where laws are based on religion, where societies are not secular, and where the people follow religious tenets and are not educated about women's equality. The state must be separated from religion so that laws can be religion-free. Islam must not be exempted from critical scrutiny, neither must any other religion. Islam, in particular, needs to undergo a process of enlightenment and reformation similar to what other religions have experienced. Women's rights are human rights. But Islam doesn't consider women to be a separate human being. It teaches that the male was the original creation, womankind was created secondarily and solely for man's pleasure. Islam treats women as intellectual, moral, and physical inferiors. In marriage, Islam protects the rights of men only. The Quran gives men total freedom within marriage, saying, "Your women are as your field, go unto them as you will." The Hadith says that two prayers never reach the heavens. First, those of escaping slaves, and second, those of reluctant women who frustrate their husbands at night. Islam considers women psychologically inferior too. They are not allowed to testify in divorce cases. If a woman is raped, she must produce 4 male witnesses for the court. If she cannot, no charge will be brought. In Islamic law, the testimony of 2 women is worth that of 1 man. If a man suspects his wife of adultery or denies the legitimacy of the offspring, his testimony is worth that of 4 witnesses. A wife has no right to charge her husband in a similar manner, nor can women inherit property on equal terms with their brothers. Allah proclaims that when an estate is settled, a male shall inherit twice as much as a female. In Bangladesh, in the beginning of the 1990s, hundreds of thousands of Islamists burned my books publicly and marched to demand my execution by hanging. Fatwas, Islamic religious edicts, were issued against me. A price was set on my head. Instead of resisting the Islamists, the government took action against me. I was accused of blasphemy and finally thrown out of my country. My crime was writing these words. It is dangerous to follow the religious scriptures in this modern world. Not only the Quran, but all the religious scriptures are out of time and out of place. And they are all anti-women. I completed 25 years of exile this month. I cannot go back to my country. Without criticism of Islam, it will never be possible for Islamic countries to separate state and religion, never possible to secularize society, never possible to abolish laws based on Islam and establish laws based on equality. If the state is not secularized, Islamic states will remain in darkness forever. And women will never enjoy the right to live as human beings. You know, in the Indian subcontinent, women have been victim of dowry murder, bride burning, gang rape, sexual slavery, and domestic violence. I'm trying my best to fight all kinds of discrimination against women by raising awareness. Across the world, the religious fundamentalism is rising, whether they be Muslim, Hindu, Christian, Jewish, or Buddhist. All religious fundamentalists oppose women's rights and freedom of expression. In supporting women's rights everywhere, I have criticized all religions, traditions, cultures, and customs that are anti-women. But to my surprise, I find myself labeled anti-Islam. Some people say I am a Muslim hater, but they are wrong. I stand beside all oppressed people. I stood beside Muslims when they were oppressed in Gujarat, in India, in Palestine. I defended their rights to live, just as I stood beside the Hindus who are oppressed in Bangladesh and the Christians in Pakistan. To me, their religious identity is not important. I consider them as human beings. No one should be oppressed because of their beliefs. I believe that no country can become civilized without criticizing the dogmatic practices of its religions. Without separating state and religion, no state or society can become modern. Democracy means nothing if it fails to provide equal rights to women. Ensuring women's rights benefits not only women, but also the men and children in their families and their societies as a whole. It also strengthens democracy and prosperity, enhances stability and encourages tolerance, protecting both the human and property rights of women and of all people is at the core of building a civil, law-abiding society. It is the foundation for true democracy. Empowering women through equal access to education and economic opportunity is essential for the eradication of poverty. It alone enables women to effectively participate in the decision-making processes that shape their communities and their lives. Education is increasingly essential if individuals are to succeed in a global and technologically advanced economy. Women's integration into the mainstream of economic life leads not only to signify economic progress for the family, but ultimately for the country as well. After I started writing, critics charged that I was influenced by Western feminism, but I had formed my own ideas regarding women's oppression long before I even heard of feminism, Western or otherwise. As I mentioned, I questioned the authoritative pronouncements of my family and society at large, even as a child. When I was not allowed to play outside, when I was called impure during my menstrual periods, or when I was told by some of my relatives and neighbors that I must cover myself completely in a burqa if I wanted to step out, I dared to question. When strange boys would hurl abuses at me, snatch my scarf, or pinch my breasts as I walked, I protested. I could not stomach it when I saw husbands beating their wives or young mothers weeping in anxiety and fear because they had given birth to female babies. Upon observing the shame on the faces of the victim of rape, I felt their pain acutely. I broke down when I heard about women and children being trafficked from city to city, from one country to another, in order to be forced into prostitution. Nothing could make me accept the torture of women by men, by society, or by the state. But no one witnessed my pain, my tears, until I started writing. I did not learn defiance from a book. It is not necessary to read thick, heavy books to be aware. One only needs sharp eyes. In order to demand rights for women, one doesn't need to internalize Simone de Beauvoir or Gloria Steinem. One's own awareness and courage can be enough. If I am hungry, I shall eat. If I am lashed, I shall wrest away the lash. If I am oppressed, I shall stand up. These sentiments are universal. Feminism is not a property of the West. It is the result of arduous struggle by abused, oppressed, tortured, disrespected, and ignored women coming together, even putting their lives at stake for the sake of their rights. I have learned that women of the West have had no less than their share of suffering. Abused and bloodied, they have had their backs to the wall. For centuries, they have been victims of patriarchy, religion, misogynistic traditions, and the like, just like their Eastern counterparts. Religious fanatics have burned them alive. Misogynistic traditions have imposed metallic cages on their bodies in the name of chastity. They have been turned into sex slaves, east or west, north or south. Women still suffer for the crime of being women. Human rights are universal. Those who speak of separate, lesser human rights for the people of the East and seek to distance themselves from the concept of universal human rights, thinking that this stance represents a victory over prolonged oppression by the West, actually end up harming the East more than the West. I want to read a poem of mine. The title of this poem is You Go Girl. They said, take it easy, said, come down, said, stop talking, said, shut up. They said, sit down, said, bow your head, said, keep on crying, let them tears roll. What should you do in response? You should stand up now, should stand right up, hold your back straight, hold your head high. You should speak your mind, speak it loudly, scream. You should scream so loud that they must run for cover. They will say, you are shameless. When you hear that, just laugh. They will say, you have a loose character. When you hear that, just laugh louder. They will say, you are rotten. So just laugh even louder. Hearing you laugh, they will shout, you are a whore. When they say that, just put your hands on your hips, stand firm and say, yes, I'm a whore. They will be shocked. They will stare in disbelief. They will wait for you to say more, much more. The men amongst them will turn red and sweat. The women amongst them will dream to be a whore like you. Thank you.
Amazing. Taslima, amazing. Really amazing. I know you are going to be, and you are a role model for many. You go, girl. Later on. Possible. Feminism is not property of the West, and human rights are universal. Definitely. Thank you so much.